Chapter 17. Lancaster said goodbye on the following morning, and by noon he was in Edinburgh. At the Travellers' Club he found a letter from the firm of publishers, at home, that had lately been using a great many of his sketches. They took the liberty of informing him that owing to the popularity of his work they had thought proper to open an exhibition of his original sketches in the museum art galleries. While they were aware that possession of these originals was entirely vested in themselves, they had decided to lay aside a share of the receipts from the exhibition and sale for him, as a courtesy royalty. Lancaster folded the letter up, drummed on the table for a second or two, and then went out to get a paper. It had occurred to him that, if he sailed for home at once, he could reach there before the exhibition closed. It would be a grim bit of humor to appear there in person, and listen to the comments of the very people who, a year ago, would have considered him and his work beneath their notice. Now, with a European reputation, his stock, so to put it, had gone far beyond par in his native country. Besides, the memory of the things that Mrs. Stewart had said to him refused to pass from him. There was Dorothy. He would see her again, he would put his faith to the touch once more. It had been a white night that had passed between his conversation with Mrs. Stewart and his departure from St. Andrews. He had lain awake listening to the hissing of the sea over the rocks, and recounting the arguments that affected his feelings toward Miss Ware. Now, it had seemed to him that she represented for him the one chance of happiness, that the touch of sadness that had come to her would make her but the more merciful to his own past. Then, again, the old bitterness, the old distaste came. He could not escape the thought that the old conventions teach, that one step aside means, for the woman, eternal disgrace. Well, and even if the old conventions said so a thousand times, were they to bind him now, when they had so long been thrust away by him in scorn? At any rate, the torment of these conflicting thoughts was to be avoided. He must decide upon one attempt or another: the return home and the repetition of a certain question, or the effort to continue more steadfast than ever in the philosophy of laughter. He decided for the return to America. No boat left Liverpool for 2 days. In the interval he roamed about the most beautiful city in Scotland, enjoying the memories and pictures of the past that Holyrood, the old castle, and John Knox's house brought up. The autumn sun turned Prince's Street Gardens, and the Scott Monument into a green and gold and flowered picture that he remembered no equal to. In his wanderings through the capitals of Europe, Prince's Street, he maintained, was the prettiest thoroughfare in the world. He left it with regret. His voyage across the Atlantic merely gave him material for a study of the gowns adopted by the fair ocean travellers, and several chances for cynical representations of the humours of upper deck flirtations. Otherwise his journey was as monotonous as the luxuriance of the modern travel could make it. It was morning, when after another fatiguing journey by rail, he reached the metropolis that held so many mixed memories for him. He went straight to the Philistine Club, and took some rooms there. The servants hardly knew him. He had, it was true, changed a great deal. He was browner, thinner. There were deep lines about his eyes and mouth. The first man he met in the smoking room, after he had refreshed himself with a bath and a lunch, was Vance Truther. "Why," said that gentleman, after a long, puzzled look, "dashed if it isn't Dick Lancaster, come into the light, most noble genius, and let me gaze upon you. You put bright crimson tints on all the effete European cities, didn't you? I declare it's good to see you again. You've seemed a good deal like a myth lately, you know. No one ever seemed to know just where you were, or whether you were alive at all." They walked up and down the room, asking and answering such pleasant questions as come between two familiars after a long absence. "Oh, there's not much change," Vance Truther was explaining, "except in yourself. You'll be no end of a lion, I'm afraid. Have to do a couple of paragraphs about you myself, just to scoop the other fellows. Give me a text or two. Oh, but you have hit the fad in the exact center, somehow. I'm not saying a thing against the real value of your stuff. But the fact remains that this whole blessed nation is fad mad just now, and it simply has got to have a fad or quit. Your European reputation came along just about the time the fad for the newest English novel was dying. You went, so to say, with a whoop. One can't pick up a Sunday paper now but what one finds weird, impossible interviews with you, descriptions of your favorite models, or reproductions of your newest squitch. You are depicted as the founder of a new style, they talk of women as being Lancaster-like, and you are a pest generally. In print, I mean, of course, only in print. You are about to furnish my own dear self with material for about a column, so I shouldn't call you a pest. But from the standpoint of the reader, rather than the penny A-liner, I abhor you, he made a gesture of aversion, laughingly. You want to know about the old guard, do you? Well, Stanley is still the same dismal distiller of cynicisms that he ever was. His trip abroad only seems to have made him worse. Belden? Oh, he plods along in the same old way, drawing bloody battles for the dailies, and making all creation look like the prize ring duffs. We have the same old Sunday evenings up at his house, too. His wife's turned out well, as far as one can see. He certainly doesn't look unhappy. We were all up there not long ago, Moss Borer, Stanley and myself. Mind you, I never take Mrs. Van. I'm about the same as ever, too. I've got a blood-curdling dime novel on the stocks just now, and the season is beginning for the winter, so I'm not likely to have much time for idle trifling for a while. Oh, comma, did you see Mrs. Stewart while you were abroad? Thanks. That'll be another scoop on the rest of the society editors. Hello. 3 o'clock, comma, got to be off to the office, see you again, he rushed off, leaving Lancaster smiling at his frank, jerky sentences. Lancaster sat down and took up the morning paper. Before long the advertisement of his exhibition at the museum met his eyes. It occurred to him that if what Van Struthe had said was only in part true, it would be wise for him to go and take a peep at the show this very afternoon, before people knew he was in town. The place was crowded with well-dressed men and women. They flowed in and out in a constant stream. They held catalogues in their hands, and chatted volubly. In front of one picture, whereon was depicted a London music hall scene, there was an especially large gathering. He's so dreadfully cynical, don't you think so? One man was saying to the girl that was with him, I really think he ought to be called a caricaturist. Oh, but, after all, it's nearly all true, you know. Look at the expression on that gallery god's face, will you? Wonder what sort of a chap he is personally? Oh, impossible, I suppose. Although I ought not to say that, nothing is impossible nowadays, there never was such a run on intellect. I never saw anything like it. It positively seems as if society was intellect mad. Singers, actors, painters, writers, all sorts of queer people go everywhere now, and that isn't the worst of it. The society people won't be content with just playing at society as they used to, they want to sing, and paint, and write, too. It's awful. I'll have to go on the stage, or something of that sort, myself, if I want to keep up with the procession. Lancaster moved away from that corner. It was amusing, certainly, but it was also painful. What pleased him more than the overheard conversations were the little labels, displaying the word soul that decorated many of his sketches. It was balm to him to think that these moneybags, these puppets mumbling set phrases, were being despoiled of some of their wealth for his sake. Walking over to the wall whereon hung the sketch for which Wooton had been the unconscious model, Lancaster heard a voice that seemed familiar. It certainly looks like him, the voice was saying, that would be a wanton brutality. It was Miss Tremor. Lancaster flushed angrily. What had she to judge by? It was Mrs. Tremont who was accompanying her daughter. The elder lady moved away, that moment, to speak to an acquaintance. Miss Tremont remained in front of the picture of the drunkard, her brows moving nervously. Lancaster stepped close up to her. If I were you, he said quietly, but distinctly, I should go and look after him. He needs it. The girl started quickly, turned momentarily pale, and then, seeing who it was, nerved herself to stony calmness. How dare you? She said, twisting her catalogue into shapelessness. Oh, he laughed, I really mean it for the best. As you see, he looked sneeringly at the sketch, he's not the pink of sobriety. And when he drinks, he talks a good deal. He sometimes talks about you, for instance. He paused and seemed engrossed in nothing save the smoothing out of the wrinkles in his gloves. You coward, if intention could have killed, Miss Tremont's eyes committed murder. True, I fear for you both. And I take such an interest in you. But I believe he will make an excellent husband for you. He lifted his hat, with a fleeting mockery of a smile, and left her before the picture, staring, trembling. That, he told himself, was wanton brutality number two. But she should not have judged me. He left the galleries, taking with him a feeling of scorn for himself, that he should have put himself on the level of the praise or blame of the faddists in such a public way. Yet, he reflected, it had been not of his own seeking. The afternoon was already touched with the darkening shadow of evening. The town roared and hissed and seethed in all its wonted fervour. The chill hardness of its material manners were painfully evident to Lancaster as he came from the comparative quiet of the picture galleries. He contrasted the grim roar of the place with the smiling, careless, jovial glitter of those other towns he had lately enjoyed. For the bright cheer of the boulevards and the gardens and the open-air cafes, he found the sky-piercing buildings that shut out the sunlight, hemmed in masses of money-mad humanity, and extended apparently to all the horizons. For the strolling gaiety he had grown to love so, for the ever-changing current of picturesque triflers, idlers and dandies, he had received in exchange a breathless surge of anxious, nervous, straining men and women, plunging wildly down the slopes to an imaginary sea of gold. Something of the old repulsion made itself felt in him. He foresaw that it would never again be possible for him to endure life here. That other glittering, careless, joyous maelstrom, perhaps, this one, never. He realized that while for future generations it was possible, for himself the hope of finding an American metropolis tinged with aught but the feverish strivings after riches was utterly vain. He tried to argue with himself about it, to persuade himself that it was a nobler sign, this one of the masses all honest in labor and in pursuit of its fruits, than the evidences of inherited wealth, or quiet content with small means, that were the prevailing notes of older countries. But he failed. His temperament rebelled. He loved the smooth, the finished sides of life. The artist in him rebelled against the commercialism of his native haunts. If it should be the degree of faith that he continued to seek out life's most distracting enchantments, he would certainly have to bid his native land farewell again. If there were anything else in store for him, if it happened that he be required by Dame Chance to do something more serious than to laugh, and laugh well, that consideration would bear postponement. It seemed to him, as he walked through the streets that were now beginning to glitter with the white and yellow lights born of electricity and gas, that these faces were the same faces always, that there was never any change, from year to year, in the puppets that paraded on this urban stage. A thousand differing types, to be sure, but always the same in their hard, tense, sinister look of restraint. All wore the same tiring eyes, the same rounded shoulders. The same fierce passion for excitement swam in the eyes of the women. In his morbidness he fancied that it was as if all these city dwellers were life prisoners, condemned forever to walk, and mumble and laugh shrilly. The metropolis, he told himself, is a maelstrom that never gives up its human prisoners, it merely changes their cells occasionally. At which reflection he presently laughed. The old text came to him. The thing to do is to laugh, yes, he thought, but it's harder here than anywhere else. Much harder. Arrived at the club, he ordered dinner, and in the short interval, sat down to write a letter to his mother. For the many months of his absence abroad he had contented himself with sending her occasional newspapers, the briefest of notes, and illustrated magazines. In none of these missives had there ever been the real personal, familiar note. He had given merely the scantest news of his whereabouts and his well-being. In the life and the philosophy he had chosen there was little room for comradeships, even with his own mother. Now, however, with the distance between them so vastly less, he felt again some of the old affections that he had thought to have slain with laughter. In any event, he wrote, whether he decided to remain on this or that continent, he would pay Lincolnville a visit presently. They would have that dear, delightful talk that the months had despoiled them of. As he stepped into the dining room, Van Struthen nailed him. "Saw a friend of yours just now, Dick," he said. "Miss Ware, ah," was the reply, given in apparent abstraction. "They still live here then?" "Yes." "Dick, did it ever occur to you that she's a devilish pretty girl?" "Oh, look here, Van," said Dick, laughingly, "I came to feed on solids, not the lilies of your imagination. The prettiest thing in the world to me, at this date, is a good dinner."